Hello, my soccer universe. The sensation is complete. The team that I followed from childhood, my hometown team, is qualified out of the Europa League group stage. If you would have told me that even last year, I would not have believed it. I do recognize that an Austrian team at the moment that is second in the league, you would expect them to qualify, but given that we have no experience in Europe whatsoever, I mean, I remember myself watching one European Cup game in 99 against our Bucharest at home that we lost 2-3, and that was it in my entire life up until last year when we had a teeny run in the Europa League qualification where Besiktas kicked us in the nuts with a 90th minute goal that got us out of the qualification round. Beating Basel was already huge. Then not making the Champions League, okay, was expected. We did all right, I would say. The videos are there. Coming into Europa League group stage, I actually thought, this will be a tough task to even become third. I mean, there's Trondheim. The Trondheim actually takes a deep dive. No one expected. And I also have to say, the luck was on our side. PSV Eindhoven, when we played them, it really helped that Marlon and Bergwijn were injured. The injury bug really hit PSV. But, and you know, even Sporting and so on. So it was, the stars aligned, but still, you gotta make it. It could have gone the other way. I'm through the moon. I am wearing my Europa League away jersey that they played in yesterday. I thought they will play in pink. I didn't expect Rosenborg to play in all white. The weather conditions were wonderful at the beginnings. As you would expect from a Norwegian game high up north, snowfall. The pitch was almost white when they took off the Europa League patch. It was green below, everything around was white. It actually looked quite interesting. But I thought, this might be hard because they're not used to that. Fortunately, the weather conditions, within 10 minutes it stopped snowing and then the field became more playable. They still played all the time with the red ball. So be it. I think LASK started well, but the first chance fell to Rosenborg, who in the 15th minute, glorious chance on the honestly. Fortunately, we have a really good goalie now, team goalie, who saved it. Then in the 20th, Goiginger with a corner kick for the ages, at least from our perspective, takes it. It goes directly into the goal. Yes, keeper Hansen, he did not expect it, but he didn't make a good figure there as well. I mean, he was there and then it goes through his hands. But the game was actually kind of nervy. I thought that Trondheim was disrupting our play quite well, and the defense, you know, I did not feel as secure as in other games before. I have to say though that right before half there were three chances. One through Michael, a nicely put shot bounces off the floor. Then Ramftl and then another one. So there were chances to make it 2-0, and then exactly when you thought, okay, we'll be 1-0 at half, Bjørn Johnsen, he's American, so we can say Johnsen, makes it 1-1 before the half. I was a little bit disappointed because at that point, Sporting already had a 3-0 lead over PSV Eindhoven. Luis Felipe and Bruno Fernandes within 15 minutes had a 2-0, and the shot by Bruno Fernandes, if you haven't seen it, wide range shot directly into the net. I have to say, I don't like those PSV away jerseys, but the way they played against Sporting, that was color-wise first the best thing. And Mathieu actually had made it 3-0 at the half. So for me, it was kind of, we need to get this win somehow. All I wanted was a dirty 1-0 win. Well, I want to have a dirty 2-1 win. My dreams came true, to be honest. LASK was better in the second half, as they frequently are. They get better the longer the game. It's also, I think, the superior fitness as compared to many other opponents, really shines through. And yeah, it was a nice cross from Raftel from the side that hits Frieser on the who dives into it. Again, Hansen is with the hands there, but it goes in 2-1, and then Frieser should have made it. He had two chances to make it 3-1, and then there were many more. It should have been 3 or maybe even 4-1. Yes, Trondheim had also two chances thereafter, but they hang on. LASK wins the group, and Sporting actually adds a fourth one through a penalty, also by Bruno Fernandes. I cannot quite believe that happening, because Sporting was a team that LASK dominated in Lisbon. That they lost there is still one of the flukiest results I've seen in my life. They played for 5 minutes. LASK played for 80 minutes. And had chances, 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 and they cannot get the win. With that win, it didn't matter in the end. We're through. Very happy about that. I'm a little bit worried about PSV Eindhoven. But so be it. So the table now, if you look at it, Sporting has 12, LASK 10. 2 weeks' time, LASK has home game Sporting for first place. They're a dream even more. PSV 7, thanks to the head-to-head that LASK won against PSV, they cannot progress into second anymore in Trondheim without points, is last. I did not see many highlights of the other games, to be honest. I saw some goals, namely Arsenal-Frankfurt, and you know, here they are, let you know. But let's run through the groups one by one. In Group A, Sevilla beats Karabakh 2-0. I saw the 2-0 by Munas Tabur. And Dudelange loses at home to Apoel Nicosia. What that means is that both Sevilla and Apoel are through to the next round. Sevilla with a perfect record, as you would expect in that group. And Apoel wins the head-to-head against Karabakh. In Group B, we had an absolutely crazy, probably the game of the evening. I got that it was crazy between Malmö and Dynamo Kiev. Malmö took an early lead. Dynamo Kiev, within a minute, I think, made it 2-1. That was me misreading it in the morning. No, in the 18th, made it 1-1, and then Zigankov in the 39th made it 2-1 for Dynamo. Rosenborg in the 48th gets the equalizer, and Rakib in the 57th takes the lead for Malmö again. So up until that point, perfect game. Did not quite end super perfect, but it was an amazing game. Verbic in the 77th equalizes, and then in stoppage time, 96th minute. That was 6 minutes stoppage time given. Rosenberg makes it 4-3, keeps Malmö squarely in the running. In the other game, Copenhagen gets a 1-0 win over Lugano. Quickly, Malmö played actually in their away jerseys, which is, and I know I have to do an Europa League jersey review. I'm gonna try to do it this to get the first videos out this weekend. I have a plan. Probably by the end of by match day 6, we should be through that. So in the game table now, we have Copenhagen 9, Malmö 8, Dynamo 6, but nothing yet decided, because Copenhagen and Malmö play in the last round against each other for a spot, and even a draw would not really help either one, because Dynamo with a win. And if Malmö only makes a point, is through to the next round. And I don't know how it is in Copenhagen. Let's see. Copenhagen, Dynamo, 1-1, 1-1 is also all square. So lots to play for there. And Malmö, Copenhagen, those two towns are very close. They're just separated by the Öresund Bridge. So kind of a derby. Talked already about Group D, but Group C was a very early game. Krasnodar beating Basel, keeping themselves in the running. Getafe beating Trabzonspor, basically eliminating entirely Trabzonspor. In that table now, Basel 10, Getafe and Krasnodar 9, all to play for. Last round, Basel Trabzonspor, so Basel should be through, and then Getafe Krasnodar 4, the final spot, more or less. Group E, Lazio gets it done. 1-0 win over Cluj. That was their last straw, and now they need help. Celtic beats Rennes 3-1. So if Lazio wants to advance, they need to hope that Cluj loses at home to Celtic, and they need to win away from home against Rennes. So still a long shot, to be honest. Group F was kind of remarkable. Guimarães, Liège, two late goals in the first half. First a penalty for Liège, and then Guimarães equalizes. And what jersey was Guimarães playing in? It was a bluish or grayish. Didn't quite understand those. But this is 1-1, and it ends that way. And in London, Arsenal has a pretty good first half with a right in stoppage time. Aubameyang giving the lead to Arsenal. But then suddenly it fell sort of apart. Frankfurt got itself back in the game. Kamada in the 55th and 64th turns the game around. And Frankfurt hangs on to win it, which puts them pretty much now in the driver's seat for a spot in the next round. We have Arsenal 10, Frankfurt 9, Liège only 7. And yes, Liège has a home game against Arsenal, but Arsenal won the first one 4-0. So I'm not sure if they can win the head-to-head. Frankfurt just needs a win against Guimarães, who are last. Group G, that's one of the craziest ones. Young Boys squanders a halftime lead 1-0 and loses 2-1 to Porto. And Feyenoord against Rangers also played a quite epic game. Feyenoord took the lead, then Rangers turned around through Morelos, and then Sinisterra makes it 2-2, and it ends that way, which means now Feyenoord is in trouble. Rangers, 8 points, leads the table, and I gotta say, this is, to me, a surprise. Porto and Young Boys at 7, Porto wins the head-to-head, and Feyenoord only 5 points. Both Scottish teams really doing well in the Europa League, has to be said, given where Scottish football stands now in the UEFA standings. That's not to be expected. Group H had also some late magic, kind of. We have a 1-1 between CSK and Ludogorets Razgrad. That was all in stoppage, in regular time. Ludogorets took the lead. CSK equalized all in the second half. Ferencváros Espanyol ends in a 2-2 draw, with Ferencváros taking twice the lead. The second time was already in stoppage time of the second half, through a penalty, and Darda in the 96th equalizes, so another very late drama, which puts Espanyol through here. Espanyol has 11 points, Ludogorets and Ferencváros have the last spot, 7 and 6 points respectively. CSK is out, and it last round is the decider. Ludogorets is home to Ferencváros, so all to play for there. Group I got fully decided with not many goals. Saint-Étienne, Ghent ends 0-0. And Wolfsburg wins against Alexandria through a penalty from Weghorst. And that means Ghent and Wolfsburg are through with 9 and 8 points respectively, which is ridiculous. A little low total. Saint-Étienne has 4, Alexandria 3. So Ghent and Wolfsburg are through there. Group J, unfortunately for the other Austrian team, it didn't. It all fell apart, and now since the coach went to Burnley, I think. They won 4-0 in Gladbach. Now they lose at home 1-0. Had, again, a very good first half, and they cannot get the goals. What can you do? And then Stindl completes a nice attacking move. May makes 1-0, and there was not much danger for Gladbach. Then and then Başakşehir here loses at home to Roma. There was a penalty given to Roma in the 30th at Veretout. Nicely converts, I have to say. And then 5 crazy minutes. Kluivert in the 40th and Dzeko in the 45th make it 3-0. And Roma looks now good in that table as well. Gladbach 8, Roma 8. Head-to-head goes to Gladbach. Gladbach should not be in this. I mean, they had 3 stoppage time goals that completely changed their path. I gotta say that. I mean, Gladbach is a good team. Don't get go wrong. But riding their luck big time. Big time. Wolfsburg, unfortunately, out of the running. Gladbach, Başakşehir here play next round in the Roma against Wolfsburg. Group K. We had Besiktas winning against Slovan, didn't help much, and Braga getting a lead, then Wolves score 3 to have a 3-1 lead, but Braga manages to equalize late. Paulinho and Fran Sergio in the 64th and 79th make it 3-3, also a spectacular game. Braga, therefore, top in the table. Wolves is second, and Slovan and Besiktas are out. And Group L, last one, was also a group that was played early, with a quite remarkable result. Astana beating Manchester United 2-1. United took the lead through Lingard in the 10th, and then Shomko and Bernat with an own goal. Eigentor. That's the... turn it around. And yeah, I mean, granted, United didn't play with the first string squad, but still. The other game was also remarkable because Partizan had a 2-0 lead over in Alkmaar and looked like they can take something from there. However, very, very late. Again, very late. Cruyff in the 87th and the 92nd equalizes and Alkmaar goes through. Partizan would have needed that win, but now United and Alkmaar are through in that group. Partizan Astana are in last places. So that was match day 5 of the Europa League. As I said, I saw a little bit from everything here and there. I focused fully on LASK. I'm so happy. I cannot believe it. I'm positively giddy. I'm very tired. Also, that was a rough week and I'll have to go to work, but we'll see it how it will go. Let me know what you watched. Let me know what you thought about the games yesterday on Thursday. I don't know if this video will post Friday or Saturday. Let's see. And yeah, give me a thumbs up if you enjoyed it. Subscribe to my channel if you want to see more videos like these. And I will talk to you soon. Bye. Hey there. I hope you enjoyed this video. And if you did, here are some videos and playlists that would be of interest to you too. Also, please consider subscribing to my channel as it will keep you updated with all things that are rotating in my soccer universe. With that, I wish you a wonderful day. Bye.